Good morning, Bante. Good morning, Brian.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, Bante.
Morning, Bante. Morning, Brian.
Bante. Good morning, Brian.
Good morning, Bante G.
Good morning, Bante. Good morning, Brian.
Good morning, Bante Satterjee. Well, I saw you there too.
Good morning, Bante.
Good morning, Bante.
Good morning, Bante.
Good morning,
Brian.
Good morning, Bante. Good morning,
good morning. Good morning, Bante. Good morning, Brian. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Okay. Metta.
Good morning, Bante.
Good morning.
Teruvan Saranai.
Teruvan Saranai. Okay, let us begin with metta. May all beings be happy and secure. May all beings have happy minds. Whatever living beings there may be, without exception, weak or strong, long, large, medium, short, subtle or gross, visible or invisible, living near or far, born or coming to birth, may all beings have happy minds. Let no one deceive another, nor despise anyone anywhere, neither from anger nor ill will, should anyone wish harm to another. As a mother would risk her own life to protect her only child, even so towards all living beings, one should cultivate a boundless heart. One should cultivate for all the world a heart of boundless loving friendliness, above, below, and all around, unobstructed, without hatred or resentment, whether standing, walking, sitting, lying down, or whenever awake. One should develop this mindfulness. This is called divinely dwelling here, not falling into erroneous views, but virtuous and endowed with vision, removing desires for sensual pleasures. One comes never again to birth in the womb. With this metta thought, let us continue our practice. As I mentioned, we don't need to repeat the same meditation instructions since we have already learned them. So let us practice. We do a go off ground. dukkha patta cha nidukkha bhaya patta cha nibbhaya soka patta cha nisoka huntu sabbe pipanino. May the suffering be free from suffering. May the fear struck be free from fear. May the grieving be free from grief. So too may all beings be. With this metta wish, let us focus the mind on our Dhamma talk. Record. This is a continuation of our Bodhyanga meditation. Today we want to continue the talk on investigation of Dhamma. This is another very important, very profound part of the Dhamma. And how we do that? Buddha said, when one has a bhikkhu, Buddha said, there being discrimination of phenomena, enlightenment factor, in him, that means in us, we call it easy to understand instead of discrimination, we would say investigation, Dhamma Vichaya. That is more popular, better known word, investigation. What do we investigate? We investigate the Dhamma. When we investigate, we can do investigation in two ways. One is as a theory, other is as a practice. When we investigate theoretically, that is somewhat easier. All you have to do is to take a book, read the discourse, listen to Dhamma talk, and go to internet and take a piece of Dhamma, and you can criticizes, analyzes, and break into pieces and investigate to find the truth. You certainly can intellectually come to a conclusion of that kind of, when we do that kind of investigation. It is a very easy thing with little, with some intelligence, we can investigate the theoretically. That is what many, many of us used to do, investigate. Somebody might say, it's not very difficult thing. Anybody can investigate Dhamma. Investigate even impartially. Investigate like philosophers, psychologists, sociologists, anthropologists. They can investigate Dhamma and come to a conclusion, but they, within themselves, do not arouse an iota of insight. It's within themselves. So the Buddha gave a very practical, meaningful way of investigating Dhamma as a theory, part of meditation. How can we do that? That is the question. The discourse, in Satipatthana discourse, Buddha said, santangva ajyattang dhamma viche sambojjang gang attime ajyattang dhamma viche sambojjang goti pajanati. Meaning, when one looks at oneself, within oneself, while practicing mindfulness, one must look at oneself within the mind, one's own mind, to see whether the person is developing investigation factor of Dhamma or not. How can we do that? When we practice, we ask, when we gain some degree of concentration, composure, and so forth, ask ourselves individually, ask, am I mindful? Am I sleeping? Is my mind is wandering? Do I have anger? Do I have greed? Am I confused? Am I hallucinating? Am I daydreaming? Am I remembering the past? What am I doing now? That is the question. That is how we investigate within Dhamma within ourselves. For instance, when you are sleepy, sleepiness and drowsiness is one of the hindrances. In the hindrance section, we learn santangva ajyattang tinamiddhang attime ajyattang tinamiddhang tipajanati asantangva ajyattang tinamiddhang natime ajyattang tinamiddhang tipajanati yathaja anuppannas tinamiddhas uppado hoti tancha pajanati yathaja uppannas tinamiddhas pahanam hoti tancha padanati yathaja pahena sinamiddhas ayating anuppado hoti tancha pajanati. Like that, ask the question, do I have sleepiness? If there is no sleepiness, this is the question we ask to investigate. If there is no sleepiness, we know that there is no sleepiness. But soon sleepiness will arise. Then we know sleepiness is in us. Investigate. Then you practice investigation of Dhamma further and ask this question, this sleepiness is always making my practice weak. It is blocking my progress. It doesn't make my progress, make me develop my mind. So investigate and then let it go. Let it go. You do various things to overcome sleepiness. We have mentioned many of them. And having done all these things, you again investigate. Do I still have sleepiness? No. It is gone. And then you investigate and see, now sleepiness is gone. And the sleepiness that is gone is not coming back. So you can proceed. This is how you investigate. Investigate within yourself about effort, about your the perseverance. So investigate means looking at oneself introspectively and asking the question within oneself, am I doing something right? Am I doing in accordance with the Dhamma? Do I do things in compliance with the Dhamma, the truth? Even in the sutra at the beginning, we say, abhijja domanasang, vinaya loke abhijja domanasang. This intense greed and resentment, we have to subdue, tame. Having tamed, weakened, having overcome, or while overcoming covetousness and resentment. So in order to overcome them, one must investigate, do I have covetousness now? Do I have resentment now? And then when we have covetousness, we do something to get rid of that. If we have resentment, we have to do something to get rid of our resentment. This is how we investigate the Dhamma. And while we are doing that, then we know, now I am doing real investigation of Dhamma. Now the investigation of Dhamma, enlightenment factor is in me. I am doing that. And at the same time, keep doing it, repeating it again. That is why the discourse says, when investigation of Dhamma is not in the mind, investigation knows that that is not in the mind. When the investigation of factor is in the mind, investigation of factor knows that its investigation factor is in the mind. And when investigation factor is in the mind, then I must encourage myself to continue this investigation, practice more and more investigation. For this is a very important thing. I mentioned certain factors of Alagadupama Sutta. Alagadupama Sutta, there are two similes. One is a snake simile, one is a raft simile. Now, investigate the meaning of snake simile. Why did the Buddha use the snake simile? Within ourselves. That means if we wrongly grasp the Dhamma, that is dangerous. It is like holding a snake by its tail. So we must ask, am I holding the Dhamma correctly, or I am holding the Dhamma incorrectly? For instance, sometimes all of a sudden you may feel floating in the air. You may see a very bright light. You may see that is your spaciousness. You are spacious. When the spaciousness arises in the mind, you see, I'm enlightened. That is self-deception. When we investigate, what do we see when we investigate? We see every tiny little minute thing is in a state of flux, changing, moving, changing, changing, changing. Constantly, incessantly, things are changing. Then you know that your investigation factor of enlightenment is working within you. And the other simile is holding, like a raft. That simile says that when you realized Dhamma, understood Dhamma through the practice, then don't try to hold on to it. If you try to hold on to it, you have not liberated yourself because you are holding on to something. When we investigate, we can see this reality. When we investigate, we can see The fact that if we hold on to Dhamma and think, I know the Dhamma, I am enlightened, others are not enlightened, I am better than them, they are worse than me, and so forth and so on, one would be promoting one's own ego. When we investigate, we don't do that. We don't hold on to what we have attained. We simply attain it and pass that state and stay equanimously without trying to publicize, put in newspapers and telling in public that I'm enlightened and so on. So, see, this is the investigation of Dhamma is extremely important thing. There is another way of when we even listen to Dhamma with the investigating mind, we can see very subtle points. Very subtle point. For instance, we know there is a very beautiful discourse called Madhu Pindika Sutta in Pajjivinikaya. That was a discourse between Venerable Sariputta and Mantaniputta. Venerable Mantaniputta Venerable Sariputta asked Venerable Mantaniputta, if the practice of Dhamma, the goal of practicing of Dhamma is of the purification of virtues, Mantaniputta said no. Then he asked, the practice of Dhamma is for the purification of mind. Venerable Mantaniputta said no. Now, Venerable Mantaniputta was listening to Venerable Sariputta's question with investigating mind. So, when Venerable Sariputta asked, the goal of the practice of Dhamma is to purify virtue, he said no. Then he said, is the goal of practicing Dhamma to purify the mind? Venerable Mantaniputta said no. Then he asked, is it for the purification of views? He said no. Is it for the purification of doubt? He said no. Then is it purification for the knowledge and vision of what is the path and what is not the path? He said no. Then he asked, then why do we practice Dhamma? Do we practice Dhamma for the purification of knowledge and vision of the way? Mantaniputta said no. Then again he asked Venerable Sariputta did not know Mantaniputta himself. Sariputta knew Mantaniputta was very learned, very wise, enlightened monk. He has heard about him, but he has never seen him. He just happened to meet this monk and he simply wanted to have this in discussion. So he asked, then the practice is the purpose of practicing Dhamma to purify knowledge and vision? Mantaniputta said no. Then finally, Mantaniputta said, the practice of Dhamma is for the purification of knowledge and vision and attaining final Nibbana without clinging to anything. Then Venerable Sariputta asked, is the practice of virtue or perfection of virtue attain final Nibbana? Mantani Buddha said, no. Then he asked, purification of mind is the final Nibbana? Mantani Buddha said, no. Then he asked, is the purification of doubt final Nibbana? He said, no. Then he asked, is the purification of views final Nibbana? He said, no. Is the purification of knowledge and vision of what is the path and what is not the path the final Nibbana? Mantani Purusa said, no. Then purification of knowledge and vision of the way is final Nibbana? He said, no. So Venerable Mantani Putta listened to his questions with the investigating mind, very sharp, clear, very refined wisdom. He listened. That refined, sharp, clear wisdom arises from investigating Dhamma. Then finally, Venerable Mantani Putta said to Venerable Sariputta, I give you a simile. Wise people can understand Dhamma when they listen to a simile. So he gave a simile. Simile is, suppose King Kosala wanted to go from Saketa to Kosala to Saketa, Kosala country to Saketa. Then he arranged to arrange a trip to go to Saketa from Kosala. So what he did, he arranged a very fast, very strong, young, well-trained pairs of horses, chariot, with pairs of horses. And King Kosala goes to the first, in the first chariot, and he went to another point. This is what is called relay chariot. You all understand relay. So he goes to the second point, and then he gets off and climbs to the next chariot, and then the next chariot, and next chariot, and so forth. In the seventh chariot, he reaches Saketa. Then Saketa people would ask King Kosala, Your Majesty, did you come all the way from Kosala country to Saketa in this chariot? King Kosala said, no. Then he told them the way how he went. So, and therefore, Vendramar Mantani Putta listened to Sariputta's questions with investigating mind, and therefore he was able to understand the questions and gave a real answer. And finally, when Venerable Mantani Putta gave the simile, Venerable Sariputta did not ask further question. In fact, in this discourse in Madhupindika Sutta, Venerable Sariputta asked Venerable Mantani Putta these questions, not because Venerable Sariputta did not know the answers, when Sariputta was fully enlightened, wisest among the wise arahant monks in the Buddha's dispensation. But he wanted to get this record, put this on record for ourselves, for the sake of future generation. He just wanted to record this conversation, this point of Dhamma, of investigating for our own sake. So that is the story. Eventually, at the end, Venerable Sariputta asked Venerable Mantaniputta, may I know this Venerable's name? He said, my name is Punna. My mother name is Mantani. And therefore people call me Mantaniputta. Venerable Sariputta was so delighted when he said this. Venerable Sariputta said, had I known this early, I would have not asked you all these questions. You are the greatest monk and the wisest monk, and I have heard so much of you from the Buddha's own mouth, and many people talk very, very highly of you, in praise of you. We should take with this venerable monk from on our shoulders and take him from village to village, praising this venerable's wonderful, very great knowledge of Dhamma. Then Venerable Mantaniputta asked Sariputta, may I know what this venerable's name? He said, my name is Upatissa. My mother's name is Sari. And therefore people call me Sariputta. Then Mantaniputta said, this venerable is Sariputta, Buddha's chief disciple. The Buddha, the one has been praised by the Buddha for his wisdom. Had I known this, that I was talking to this very great monk, I would have not been so arrogant. This venerable is so great, so wonderful, the wisest of all the wise monks. I must take this venerable on my keep on my shoulders and take him round round from village to village, praising him, showing people, telling people that this is Venerable Sariputta. So they praised each other and finally ended their conversation. So all this will happen, friends, when we investigate Dhamma. The Venerable Mantaniputta listened to Venerable Sariputta's questions with investigating Dhamma. That means he investigated the question. He simply did not say no or yes without understanding the depth and width of this question. To understand the Dhamma, its depth and width, we also must investigate Dhamma. Where is the Dhamma to investigate? That is happening to us. Every fraction of the second, Dhamma is functioning within us. We must keep asking these questions. We must investigate the Dhamma that we have within ourselves. I gave few examples like hindrances, or sometimes fetters, and so forth, we learned earlier in this series of talks, and each of them happened to us, within us, in our mind, and we must investigate to see whether they are functioning in us or not. That is the practical and way of meditation to understand, to investigate the Dhamma. The other way is easier way, theoretical investigation. What the Satipatthana discourse tells us, teaches us, is practical investigation, experiential investigation, investigation in the lab. What is the lab? Lab is within us. We use our own laboratory to investigate, check out all these dhammas within us. Friends, I think my time is over. I like to end this little talk on investigation, and next time I take up the next factor of enlightenment, that is virya. So if you have questions, about investigation of Dhamma, and investigate within yourself, and then ask me questions, I will be happy to answer tomorrow. Thank you. And we want to conclude this wishing once again the purpose of this whole series is to share Dhamma with people and wish all of them liberate from their pain and suffering caused by COVID-19, and many, many of them, and this unfortunately is not reducing, it is increasing every day, and I hope this vaccine will come, will be available to people very soon. And how, at the same time, however, we want to wish them to recover very quickly and return to normal life. And there are many very wonderful, compassionate, dedicated, selfless doctors, nurses, and hospital staffs, attendants, and so on. All these actually risk their own lives, put their own life in the line of risk, and may they be safe, may they not get this virus, even very mildly, so that they will be able to continue their marvelous, compassionate service for the benefit of millions of people. And there are many people who have lost their very dear loved ones, and they were grieving. We hope they learn the Dhamma and try to recover from their grief, continue the practice of Dhamma, understand the nature of Dhamma, and liberate themselves from samsaric suffering. And there are many generous people who have been helping in many ways to get this vaccine, first to invent, now to second is distribution, and may they all be successful in distributing this as quickly as possible so that they can reduce the number of people dying and prevent people dying from this and get them back to normal health and continue their Dhamma practice. And there are many wonderful, very far-sighted leaders who are doing very wonderful jobs. They can be country leaders, leaders of states, leaders of societies, leaders of various organizations. They themselves take care of themselves and follow all the guidelines, instructions to prevent this from happening and liberate themselves from all samsaric suffering and attain liberation. With this, I want to conclude this talk, and I hope you all continue your practice. Once again, I must thank you too. You just finished your Thanksgiving. We also want to give thanks to all those who have been working hard in this very difficult time in human history to make everyone peaceful and happy. I want to thank all of them, and may you all attain liberation.
Thank you, Bhanteji.
Thank you, Bhante. Thank you, Brian. Thank you, Bhante.
Thank you, Bhante.
Thank you, Bhante.
Thank you, Bhante.
Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.
Sadhu,
sadhu,
sadhu.
Sadhu, sadhu,
sadhu. Sadhu, sadhu.
Thank you, Bhante.
Thank you. Sadhu, sadhu.
Okay. Thank you.